Hi, we're the Jeremiah Jams Band, and this is Wapaka Local Live.
Jams Band with us tonight in the studio, and we're really excited. You guys are awesome.
Thank you.
Thank you.
That was a really great, you know, when you said, oh, we're going to do this instrumental, I'm like, okay, instrumental jam song. But it was very interesting.
That's good.
Hey, that's
honestly
good to hear.
That's great. And every one of you just played wonderfully.
Thank you.
So I'm a fake music critic. Everyone that watches the show knows that. But I'm always impressed when we have great musicians on the show. And all everybody's great in their own way, but you guys are great. So
Thanks.
How's that? All right, so let's introduce the band. Let's start out with the Jamses.
Sure.
And then I'm going to ask you some questions like, first of all, is that your real name? Okay, so let's start with you, Jeremiah.
I'm Jeremiah Jams, and guitar and vocals.
Okay.
I'm Emily Jams. I play a little bit of everything. Vocals.
Right?
I'm Ryan. I play the drums.
The drums.
And sometimes percussion.
Okay. And over there?
And I'm her younger brother.
Yes, I have to, full disclosure, this is my brother, Rod Reynolds, on bass. All right. So I've seen you guys a few times, and I've watched you a lot, you know, like on Facebook and stuff. And I know that you sort of sub in the bass and the drums. Is that because you just don't like anybody, or what?
Not at all.
I mean, I can understand getting sick of that guy, but
it's. Can you blame them?
I cannot blame them. No.
It's generally because we play so much that it's hard to find people who are available as much as we play.
Right.
Is really how it all started. And then it just turned into this cool thing. We're like, wow, we're giving all these musicians opportunities to play. And it's kind of just growing into this whole family of players that we work with.
That is really cool. So, like, that's how you think of it? Because it seems like when I've started to look at what you guys do, that's what you're doing. So how many bass players do you have that work with you?
We have...
There's either five or six
five
in the rotation,
or six.
I think.
Like
yeah,
yeah wow. There's a lot. It's
and
hard to keep track.
And how many drummers?
I think five or six.
Something like that.
Two, yeah. It's
yeah,
like even.
Okay. And we do have one of the other drummers in the studio tonight.
I'm that's right.
That's Sammy.
Sammy.
He's here. Let's give a hand to Sammy.
Woo!
All right. It's always great to have a drummer because they do that. All right, so let's get down to how this all started. And I guess I am first going to say, is Jams your real name? Jeremiah Jams.
Sure is.
Really? Seriously.
Yep. It's on our driver's license.
Wow.
The Jams is, yep.
Jeremiah Jams.
Yep.
It couldn't be a more perfect name for a musician.
I've meant to play. Wow. I've played my whole life, so it's
so
not
when
a
did
surprise.
So when did you start playing?
Well, seriously about guitar, I started like when I was 12 years old to be serious about it. But I actually started when I was 9, and then took me a few years to really get the bug about it, you know, kind of thing.
So always guitar?
Always guitar.
Okay.
Yep.
And did you take lessons, or did you pick it up by yourself?
Mainly self-taught. My dad taught me like the basics, and then just kind of left me to figure out the rest on my own. Kind of deal.
So did your parents kind of want you to be a musician? Did they encourage it?
Well, they definitely encouraged me to be an artist in general. My dad was a musician. I played with him for like 20 years pretty much almost, and till he wasn't healthy enough to play anymore, and that's kind of when this idea started. But it started as solo coffee house stuff.
Okay. And then when did you meet Emily? I'm assuming you guys are a couple.
Oh, yeah, we're married.
You could be brother and sister.
What a coincidence to have those names.
You're either brother and sister or you're a couple. What is it? The audience wants to know.
We're husband and wife.
Husband and wife. Okay. And you took the Jams name because it was a cool name.
Yeah. I mean, why not?
Yeah, right. And when you guys met, did you meet through music or did you... meet otherwise? How did that all
we were both hired for an open mic thing that was every Thursday at Cranky Pat's in Neenah.
And
we just ended up being hired together, and I don't know, just kind of we like hit it off right away.
And how many years ago is that?
11.
Wow. Yeah, 11
actually
years.
This September it was 11
yeah,
years ago.
11 years.
So,
yeah,
it's a long time ago already.
Okay, and so Emily, you're a multi-instrumentalist, and I'd like to hear about like what's your first instrument, and your bow has a lot of loose hairs.
I'm due for a bow rehair. Yeah. Don't judge. I actually started on violin through like my school orchestra program. And then a year later, I started saxophone.
So did you hear that, Wetpacker? They have a school orchestra program.
Or did.
Yeah.
Where was that from?
DePere.
Oh, DePere.
Yep.
Okay. We actually have Suzuki out at the chain charter school here. So
awesome.
Nice.
We're hoping to get something going. anyway.
That's cool.
So, sorry to interrupt.
No,
it's all about me.
It's
my brother would tell you that. Okay.
It's all good.
All right, so you started out on violin.
Yep, and then a year later, I switched to saxophone, but my journey to saxophone was a little unique because I started with flute. And then the school was like, no, you need to play clarinet. So then I switched to clarinet.
What?
And then eventually I made it to saxophone.
That's
and then,
weird, because doesn't almost everybody play the clarinet?
Yeah, but my mom, who was paying the bill, is pretty stubborn and was like, nope, you're going to do flute because the fingerings, like the way you like press the keys are basically the same, almost, between saxophone and flute.
Oh.
So after we got off or over that hump, we went to clarinet and then finally saxophone.
Okay. So and, were your parents encouraging for you to be a musician?
Yes.
Did they think you were going to be, are they musicians?
My mom was a singer,
okay.
And my dad was a bass player.
Okay.
My dad performed like in like a, he had like a top 40s cover band
okay.
way back in the 70s called Tapestry.
Oh, wow.
So yeah, he did that, but my mom mostly just like sang in high school,
okay.
choir, nothing crazy.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right, so you had a lot of different instruments you played. Did you yep. play piano?
I took piano lessons like on and off. Started like the end of high school and I decided I was going to go to school for music.
Oh.
And then I had to take some like basic keyboard at Lawrence when
okay.
I was going to school there. And then after that, I basically just started playing piano because I just felt like the music needed it.
Yeah, well, and it is the best instrument too.
Yeah, it's pretty awesome. Yeah. So yeah, and then that's the last one I added, I think, was
okay.
piano. Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
So you went to Lawrence and you got a music degree.
Yep, music ed.
All right. And are you working as a teacher?
Yep. I work in Valders, way out in the sticks.
Wow.
Yep, I teach K-5 music.
Oh, you teach music.
Yep.
How fun.
It's an adventure every day.
Yeah, I
yep.
think that's fun. And do you have a day job, Jeremiah James?
Yep, I'm a network specialist for Pitney Bowes. So they make mail machines and stuff like that.
Okay.
And when those machines can't connect to the internet, I have a team of guys that I run that handles those issues.
Okay.
Yep.
Wow. Okay. So I think we'll just quick try to catch you two, and then we're going to do another song. So let's
yeah.
talk. I'm saving you for last.
Uh-oh.
And Ryan's been on our show before with the Sunrise Project.
Yep.
So you play sometimes with this band, but mm-hmm. then you also go and play with other bands.
Mm-hmm.
So this gets complex. It's like a math problem. So tell us about yourself. I know we talked to you last time you were here, but you are playing a lot of music.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Yeah, I play with these guys a lot. I play with Sunrise Project, which is like progressive jazz, just really out there.
Yes.
It's wild.
Yeah.
It's fun. Every band I play in is fun, but like that one is just like I can do whatever I want. It's pretty awesome.
Uh-huh.
Within limitation, obviously. And then I play with singer-songwriter Cody James, and I tour with him and play out with him a lot, and that's
okay.
been really fun. And then I'm in a straight-ahead jazz kind of thing called the Chalkdown Trio.
Okay.
We might be becoming a quartet. So, yeah, I've been doing a lot with them. And then just whoever calls me to do stuff. Like, I sub with the Jazz Orgies from time to time. I play with
okay.
some country bands here and there. Really, I just like to play, so it's just like drums. I
you like
doing
you
it.
You like to play drums.
Yep.
And you took drums in school.
Yeah, I actually started, well, I think my first instrument was guitar. I remember my mom bought me a guitar from Walmart. Like,
they sell guitars?
Yeah, it was something like that. She just came home with it. I'm like, oh, that's cool, but then I was...
You started hitting it.
Yeah, and then I remember drums being like, I was at Toys R Us, and I'm like, I just see this drum set, I'm like, that. And then I actually, in sixth grade, I played saxophone. Because I was afraid I was in beginning band, and what happened was I thought I was going to be late to a class. So I didn't take the percussion test because I was like, I don't want to get in trouble. I want to be a good kid. And so I played saxophone for a year, and then my parents were like, you're not going to stick with this. And I'm like, why? And they're like, because you play drums all the time. So then look at me now. So and then I went to UW Oshkosh for music business and recording, primary in percussion, and then graduated, and then I went back to grad school for a semester for world percussion performance, so like studying like a lot of like West African music, some Eastern African music, and kind of just the whole general scope.
Uh-huh.
And then
that unfortunately didn't work out for unforeseen reasons. And then I moved back here, and that was now I just play with whoever.
You just play.
Yep.
Yeah. And do you work at a music store?
Yep. Yep. I also work at Hyde Music.
Too, oh, so. That's cool.
Yep. So my life is just music.
It's all music.
Yep.
All 24/7.
Yep.
All right. What about you, Uncle Rod?
Do you have a specific question?
Rod likes to talk a lot, so maybe I'll just tell you his musical journey for him. I'll sub it. No. When did you start playing guitar? His first band was called the Rubber Band.
Oh, yeah, that was seventh grade in Rothschild.
Rothschild, Wisconsin.
Yeah. Yeah. Wasn't everybody's first band called that? No, I started playing in church at St. Teresa in Appleton, and I hooked up with some of the older kids in the folk group back when you could play really any song in church as long as it had a nice message.
Right, like Here Comes the Sun on Easter.
Yeah, awesome. Anything that wasn't evil, you could play.
Back, you know, when we were still in Vatican II.
Yeah, but now you can only play stuff that's in their book, so whatever. Yeah. Anyway, so the two other guys and me formed a band called Waiting for John, because one of the guys' name was John and he was late for everything, so they named it that. And I was about 15 or 16, and I played guitar, and they needed a bass in the group, so they got me a bass, and I prefer it now. It's all I want to play. In fact, I can't really play guitar anymore because my fingers they're rusty. They're rusty. So I've been playing pretty much all my life.
Right. Awesome. What's the other band you're in?
There's another band called Drew Hicks and Friends. And I don't think there's any other ones. Baba Ganoush, there's a possible thing that people might have heard of. I play with them. And I subbed at for Copper Box once, and I got another date with them coming up.
Yeah.
And hopefully that continues. I just want to play, and then I'm just lucky that I have such a great wife who lets me play.
Yeah.
Because I'm retired now, and it's fun to do.
All right, you guys, I'm going to ask you the name of that first song, which was such a catchy tune. What was that?
Glue.
Glue. No wonder. It's a very sticky song.
Yeah.
All right, the next song you're going to play is called what?
Sweet Babe.
Sweet Babe.
Yep.
All right, everybody. Jeremiah Jams Band.
Good? Mm-hmm. One, two, three, four. Thank you.
that was a beautiful song.
Thank you.
That was written about you.
No.
No.
It wasn't actually.
No, it actually wasn't.
Okay, well, let's hear it.
Well, I wrote that song when I was 12, after I saw Arlo Guthrie at the Grand in Oshkosh. And I was just so moved by his performance. I wanted to write something folky and something that everyone could relate to, which was like a love story. So that's where I wrote the song. Yeah.
That's awful young to be writing songs.
Yeah, I started real young. It was actually the very first song I ever wrote.
Wow, yeah. That's really an advanced song for a kid that age. So I was going to ask about the songwriting, because it seems like you guys do mostly original stuff. Mm-hmm. Do you ever do any cover band stuff, or are you mostly doing original now?
We do some cover stuff. It depends on the club. You know, if the venue really likes covers, then we'll definitely mix in some covers to our set. We always throw some originals in there, though.
Okay. So who are the main songwriters in the group? And I'm saying group, I mean you two, right? Because these guys like fly by night.
Well, these guys write their parts. So
parts
for them.
We can't take credit for that.
Yeah.
Do they actually write it, though?
Yeah. Yeah, because we don't give them written out stuff to, you know, to play. They just follow it, you know.
Yeah, that's why I got the...
You do write it down. Wow.
It's hard to remember.
I am so impressed. Okay, I'm sorry. I'm getting off track. Okay, so you two write together, or does one of you kind of start it and the other one fill in, or do you each come up with your own ideas? How does that work?
A little bit of all those things.
All of that. Yeah. Okay.
It started out with just a group of songs. I had written about an album's worth of material, and Emily helped me develop them into more pro, you know, arrangements. And then from there, we just had the spark. It just instantly grew. So now we write together all the time. Sometimes she'll write a song, sometimes I do. Sometimes we do it together at the same time.
Okay. What about lyrics? Who's the lyrics person?
It's mostly Jeremiah who does the lyrics.
Really? Okay.
I have written lyrics for some songs, but it is mostly Jeremiah who does the lyrics.
Interesting. Mm-hmm. All right, so have you ever come up with a song, either one of you, and then the other one's like, that sucks?
I don't think that's happened yet, actually. No.
Not yet?
Not yet. No. I'm sure it will eventually. But
We have a lot of stuff that we start, and then it just sits for a while.
Right.
And then we come back to it, and we add to it.
Okay.
But sometimes it just comes out. You know, Moonlight Star was written in 20 minutes.
Yeah, I wrote that on the spot.
Yep. Let It Go was another one that was written in 20 minutes. Words and everything, done.
Okay.
But then, I don't know, there's other songs that we have started and still don't have parts for.
Do you feel like you get the song kind of comes to you, and it's in there and you have to just play it? Or do you sit down and say, I would like to write a song. Let's start with a C chord. I mean, how does that process work for you guys?
For me, it's just the groove comes to me, or the song comes to me out of nowhere. Like that song Glue, I was actually working when I wrote that tune, and I was on break, and I just picked up my guitar and started playing the opening riff, and I set my guitar down, and Em's like, you need to record that. That's really cool. I'm like, really? And so I recorded it, and then it turned into that whole song.
Okay.
Where other songs just, Glue took a little work, but that one we talked about, Moonlight Star, that was instantaneous. It all came at once.
Okay.
So
the same with you, Emily?
Pretty much. I don't think I've ever written a song where I'm I'm going to sit down and write a song. It always just kind of hits me out of nowhere.
Yeah, yeah. Do songs kind of have anything to do with what's going on in your life or what you're feeling, or do you choose a topic, or does the music come? What comes first, the music or the words?
I don't know. Kind of both.
Both?
Sometimes, yeah. I guess it depends on the song.
Okay.
So, I don't know.
And do you write, when you write a song, do you write it on the violin? Do you write it on the flute? Do you write it on the piano?
I write most of my stuff on my violin, and I pluck it out.
Really?
I actually don't play with the bow. Most of the time, I walk around the house just playing it like it's a guitar.
Well, that's funny.
Yeah, I don't know. I've just always done that, too.
Okay.
But, yeah, most of it, I think every tune I've written has been written on violin.
A couple piano.
And
ones.
Most, like, even, like, parts to other songs, I'll uh-huh. write it on this, and then I'll just, like, change whatever instrument I think will
okay.
fit the song the best.
That's
I just
cool.
transpose it and play it on that.
Okay. Pretty interesting. Now, so these guys, drummers, and like, so like if you have Ryan playing with you and he's got a really great drum part and then Sammy plays with you and you're like, I want you to do it the way Ryan does it, or do you just say, do it whatever you want?
Never do that.
No, we just no. let guys play whatever they feel.
They play whatever they yeah. want to. There's no
yeah.
rules.
Yeah.
We I have like some.
I mean, you have to follow the form. That's basically
that's
the
it.
That's
yeah.
basically
okay.
the rule.
Yep. That's
okay.
Rule.
Yeah.
All right. And is the bass always electric bass, or do you ever play with a stand-up bass?
It's mostly always electric. We had mm-hmm. one guy play stand-up one show.
One time.
Okay.
Yep, we did that.
And then you got rid of him because you didn't like it?
No.
Not at all. Not at all. He just started playing electric all the time. So
oh,
we just
okay. A little bit easier way. To transport
yeah.
the electric, right?
Yeah.
Okay. All right, so we're going to do another song now, and you want to just tell us a little bit about this next song? What's the next one? I think it's going to be an instrumental, right?
Correct. Okay. This one's an instrumental. We wrote it during the pandemic when we were locked inside. So the whole premise is it's called Inside Groove Out. So we were stuck inside, but we could still groove out. And
oh.
So that's where it comes from, and it's a funk tune. So it's heavily influenced by, you know, the great funk bands. Modern one would be Lettuce and Parliament Funkadelic, stuff like that. That's kind of where the idea from it came.
Okay. All right. So you guys, you're going to get another one. All right. Jeremiah Jam.
Thank you.
have like a couple of little taglines you say on your website. You say, "The groove is calling, will you follow us?" I bet you people follow you.
Well, that's the hope.
Yeah. It's like the whole point, right? No, but seriously, I'm like getting to be one of your fans. It's really awesome. And the other thing, what was the other thing that you said on there? Oh, I'll think of it.
Okay.
Yeah, it's really great. You know, and it's really cool to hear instrumental songs that have hooks in them. How do you do that?
Got just lucky? I don't know.
Did you do that on purpose? No, it's just really great. Very exciting music. Really, really cool.
Thank you.
All right, I wanted to ask you, now you said you play a lot. And so, like, are you playing every weekend? You two, in this band. Every weekend?
Practically.
Pretty much.
Wow. Yeah. So put a lot of miles on your car?
Yeah.
Yeah?
For sure.
What's the farthest away you go to play?
That's a funny one.
This year, the farthest we've gone is Ohio.
Oh.
We went to Ohio about a month ago.
At Cleveland.
Yeah. Okay. In Cleveland.
Yeah.
That must have been kind of cool.
It's actually Fairport, Ohio.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's right by Cleveland, yeah.
So do you have an agent that books you, or do you do all this booking yourselves?
We work with Bananas Entertainment, and I book a lot of gigs on my own, too.
Okay. So I know you went up to Door County recently.
Yep.
And is it about, like, getting relationships with these bars and venues and stuff? And they ask you back? Is that how it works?
It's definitely all about relationship building when you're doing it on your own. You know, getting to know those club owners and having them familiar with you and your music and all that. And that's where that comes from. We've, you know, our whole career, we've played up in Door County. You know, we got married up there, so it's... You know, there's a lot of strong ties for us
in
that area.
Okay, cool. And what is your best gig memory and your worst gig memory?
Oh.
Let's go. You want to do best or worst?
That might be, like, the hardest question you've asked.
Yeah.
Is it?
There's a lot of good ones.
Yeah.
A lot of good ones. Okay, well, let's hear, like, what was the one that you felt like, wow, that was great. You know, we made it.
We played this really cool Grateful Dead tribute gig back in April at the Tarleton.
Okay.
It was sold out, and it was just a really cool experience just because it just felt like everybody was really there and engaged in, like, what was going on. And it was cool because it was a bunch of different bands. I think there were, like, five or six bands involved with it, too. So the whole thing was really cool. We got to play Mile of Music for the first time this year.
Of course,
that was awesome.
Where did you play at Mile of Music?
Chadwick's.
Okay, cool.
Yep.
Yeah, that's pretty fun, isn't it?
Yeah, yeah.
The energy just, like, kind of buoys you along, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah. And there's good food and friends, and it's pretty cool. Well, good for you. So, you're going to do that again, you think?
I hope so.
Yeah, we hope so.
That's the plan.
Yep.
All right, let's hear the worst gig. Did anybody throw anything at you or.
No, we haven't had too many bad ones. We played, I won't name the club, but where it is, somewhere in Wisconsin, but we played this club that we didn't know was like a half strip club. That was a little bizarre because then we set up and suddenly people started dancing that we didn't know we were going to be dancing. And
was
pretty, like, we didn't know anything about that. It was billed as like a regular place, so that was a little out there. But that's probably the worst one that happened. Rod was not with us at that time. Yeah, no.
That, I mean, I think there's a scene in, like, Magical Mystery Tour where they're playing in a strip club.
I think that was the gig, too. They came up with, like, 12 Luke Bryan songs they wanted us to play.
Oh, yeah.
Is that the same one?
Yeah.
I don't remember.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But in general, they're mostly good gigs, right?
Yeah.
We've been blessed with a very positive experience, like, 99% of the time when we play.
So that keeps you going.
Because
that's a lot. I mean, every weekend, you're working all week, and then you're playing on the weekends.
Mm-hmm.
Do you feel like that's what you want to keep doing? Do you have any ideas that maybe you'll just do music full-time, or what's your goal?
That's the dream, you know, is working there financially is the other aspect of actually getting there. It's tough to make up that, you know, salary. The whole reason I got into IT work was just so I could fund music, because I knew you can't get anywhere unless you have some money, you know, and it costs a lot of money just to have a basic band and to really do things and advertise and all that stuff, you know, and we've developed as a band. We're LLC'd now as a band, okay. too, so it's a big step moving in the right direction business-wise.
Okay.
And we're hopeful maybe in a year or two we can quit our day jobs and just play music.
Well, and you guys, and this, maybe I really want to get this in there, but aren't you working on some recorded music? You're doing some recordings, right? And you did you play any of the songs yet tonight from, don't you have a new song that you just did?
Yep,
we just released a single. We're working on our third album right now.
Okay.
We released Be True to Yourself on July 19th. We did not play that here yet.
Okay.
I think we have that on the list for
the Grand
the
National Lounge.
Set.
Yep.
Okay.
And then I believe next Friday our second single is coming out.
Okay.
Can I tell them the name?
Yep, you can tell them.
Uncle Buck.
Uncle Buck is the name of it. Yeah,
we wrote it watching the '80s classic Uncle Buck.
Oh my gosh, that's funny.
Yeah, so that one's coming out next Friday.
So are you, where can people find your music?
Everywhere.
Okay.
Anywhere.
Yeah, like iTunes, YouTube. Amazon Music, everywhere.
Okay. Yep. Spotify.
Yep.
And if they go to your website, that will also have your music on it because that's where I've listened to it.
Yep, you can listen to it on the website and purchase it there as well.
Okay, do you guys produce albums or CDs, or you just basically do digital? What are you working on?
We do physical media too, but we usually sell out. Like the last couple albums, we sold out right away, and so it's kind of one of those things. We do a batch.
What a problem.
Yeah. It's a good problem, but we just do the batch when it first comes out and then, you know, see how it goes. So that's kind of what we've been doing. With the singles, we don't do any physical media with that. That's all straight digital.
Do those singles turn into an album someday, or is that like how you do it?
Correct. Yep. We
just do them one at a time. That's weird.
Mm-hmm. It's become the new way to...
That's the way it's done now?
Yeah, now you release it as mostly singles, and then you release the album at the end, because albums have just become like a playlist to people. You know, they don't mean what they used to anymore. And you get more mileage when you release songs individually. It really builds the whole, you know, rave around the band, you know. Like with this one... We're doing a cool thing. We partnered with a national artist named Caleb Williams, who's worked with like Billy Strings and Fish and all these big bands. He was nice enough to agree to work with us, and we did this cool concept for the album art. Each song is a character from the full album artwork, because there's a bunch going on in it. And you can only see the character for each song, and then after the three singles are released, you'll see the full album artwork with all the characters in the album artwork.
Wow.
So that's
so
exciting.
Who does the artwork?
His name is Caleb Williams.
Oh, that's the guy that does the artwork. Okay.
Yep.
Wow, this is very complex. And I want to just ask a question about your students, so they know that you play in a band.
Yep.
What do they think about that?
They think it's pretty cool. I play at, one of the families has a vineyard out in Reidsville, which is not very far from Valder's, Solarian Vineyards. And we've been lucky to play there the last 2 years. And a lot of my students get to come and see me play.
That's cool.
And it's just really cool. They get really excited. And like it's cool to see them like dancing to our music. And,
oh, my gosh. That's so
this
cool.
This year, like, we got done playing, and they just, like, all came up. I felt like a rock star. It was really cool.
A mob of kids around
But
her.
It's cool. It's you know, cute. My hope is that, like, they see me doing it, and they want to do
right.
it, you know, of course.
Yeah.
But, like, you know, it's just... I don't know, it means
inspiring.
A lot to it means a lot to me to be able to inspire anybody to try it. You know,
do you have any
that's what
kids,
it's all about.
Do you have any kids that you think are like really musical in your class?
I have a lot of very musical students.
That's awesome.
They're all I don't know, they're all great.
That's cool. All right, you guys. So you wanna just tell us your website address?
It's jeremiahjamsband.com.
That's pretty easy to remember.
Yep, it's an easy one. And you find us on Facebook, Instagram, TikTok, YouTube, all that stuff.
All the things.
Mm-hmm. We're everywhere.
Yep.
Wow. How much do you dedicate to your marketing? How many hours a day?
There's a lot to marketing the band. It is a huge part of that, of running a band and getting any recognition is living and breathing social media. It's a huge part of my life.
We work on it at least every day. Like Christmas, I think, is the only day we take off.
Correct.
So it's hard work being a musician, is what you're saying.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, the way we do it.
Yeah.
I don't know if that's but the way everybody does it.
You're doing all of the parts of it. And you're managing these guys.
It's definitely harder being those two than it is us.
Yeah. You guys are just like, oh, I'm going to go on vacation next week. They just show up. No, they're very important. It's great that you have high-level players to play with you. That's really cool.
We're very fortunate to play with everybody who plays.
It's not just, very easy chord progressions. You got to have really good musicians. So.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
All right. What's your last song going to be before we cut this off?
Yeah, the last song is called Sunset Taillights. It's just a song about cruising down the road. I actually wrote it with my dad. So it's one of the older ones in my catalog for sure, but it's a groovy little tune.
All right. Well, it's been really a pleasure having you guys, and can't wait to see you down at the lounge and see you out playing, and everybody go to their website to see where they play so that you can catch them and buy their music. And anything else you want to mention before we do the last song?
The groove is calling. Will you join us?
All right, everybody, Jeremiah Jams Band.
One, two, three, four.